Hey guys, we are in the basement, and today, yes, today guys, we're gonna do a, well, we're gonna start a new arcade restoration series right here on this video. Yes guys, it is part number one of the Mortal Kombat 2 restoration. And I'm excited to get in the garage because it's a beautiful day. And also, you know, we did do kind of, well, I guess this is maybe like part two, but we did another video where we showed the pickup and the overview of the game. So go back and watch that. Now I'll put a link in the bottom if you missed kind of the first part of this series. And then also back here, I do want to show you guys, if you guys follow me on Twitter, I tweeted yesterday that my journey was broken. And what happened was the right side of the screen was collapsed. And actually, I'll show you an image here. So you can see the right side completely collapsed, which is weird, because usually when you have, this is actually called vertical collapse, and usually you would have it, and by the way, it's a vertically oriented monitor, so when you say horizontal or vertical collapse, you have to kind of think about the monitor's orientation as if it was a television, right? Because that's its normal orientation, and mounting them vertically was kind of novel for arcade games. But anyway, so this right here is actually vertical collapse, okay? So it's like this, but really on a normal TV, it would be like this, right? So vertically it's collapsed. And actually only the bottom half was collapsed, which is really weird, especially with raster monitors. So that thing was collapsed and I was totally bummed out. And I actually Googled this. I said, you know, G07 vertical collapse. And I saw some people saying that the yoke could be the cause, the yoke connection could be the cause of this. And so I fixed it. I basically just opened the back door and I just started wiggling the yoke wires that go to the chassis. And I also wiggled the jumper wires, because on the G07, there's position jumpers that change kind of you can kind of shift the picture left and right or up and down by moving these jumpers. So I wiggled those jumpers and bam, it just came back to life. So I think that when I moved the game, that somehow that connector or those jumpers got jarred. So I just wanted to share that with you guys, because a lot of you guys on Twitter were asking me what I did to fix it and what was wrong and all that stuff, because it was a bit of a bummer, because we thought we were going to be doing a Journey Restore part number 27 because of that. But no, it was something very simple. I got really lucky, honestly. All right, so what are we doing in this video? I'll tell you, we're going to go to the garage, guys. That's right. I want to get working on the Mortal Kombat 2. Because we need to get this game done before the snow comes, before winter comes, because that's my plan. My plan is to bring the game down here. So I need to take advantage of the nice weather today. So we're gonna go in the garage and get to work on the Mortal Kombat, and I wanna work on the control panel. That's what we're gonna work on here. So I've got all the parts, and we'll go to the garage and I'll show you guys what we have, and I'll thank all the guys that helped me get these parts, because you guys are freaking amazing. Anyway, enough of that. Let's just go to the garage and get to work on the Mortal Kombat 2. Alright guys, we are back in the garage, and yes, we're gonna get to work on the Mortal Kombat 2, and I am excited! So, you can see I cleaned up the garage. How does it look, guys? And also, you can see over here, the dartboard is now in the garage. I didn't actually show that in the last video when I was moving the Firefox and Quantum down. I actually meant to show you guys this being removed, but it's in the garage for now. I'm not gonna sell it, I'm gonna keep it. I actually need to fix it because the 20s are not registering. So I'm not sure what I'm gonna do with the dartboard, but I just can't get rid of it. I like it too much. And then over here, we have the xenophobe just hanging out, and we got that working 100%. I need to replace the speakers and really clean it up and restore the black. And over here is the pole position 2, which is currently dead. I need to figure that out. And then also, today I've been playing with the Bronco pinball machine, which is an EM pinball machine from the 70s, I think, by Gottlieb. And I really do want to work on this thing, but it's kind of flaky. If we start it up here, and if I try to coin it up, it doesn't really work. You have to kind of manually reset the game. So if I come in here and try coining it up, let's see if I can do it. So it's registering the coin up, but then the game just doesn't start. You see that? And then if I go in here and just kind of manually reset it, and there's like a bunch of switches and coils and relays and stuff. So if I come in here and do the reset control, like that, just hit that thing. And then if I try to start it and coin it up, it usually does. So I don't know. We're gonna have to go through this thing and just clean it up. So let's see if it starts now. No, it's not registering the coin. Let me try it again. So we'll come in here. I usually just keep playing with this and eventually it'll go. All right, so there's the reset. Let's coin it up. I'm kind of manually, it's not registering the coin up now. Let's see. Reset. And then let's see if we can coin it up again. There we go. And then let's see if it starts. There, see? I think it just started, or did it? Let's see. So the flippers are working. So let's see if we can play a game here. Let's see what happens. Yeah, so it's totally working. And it doesn't, it plays really weird and slow because I have it on these kind of wheel casters so I can roll it around. But when we get this thing going, and I do plan on going all the way with this machine, I'm gonna really wax it up and clean it and have a real aggressive angle so it plays fast. But I don't know, I kind of am into this thing. I think it's cool. I have no idea if I can get it in the basement, but I think it's neat. And everything's working, it seems, as it should. It's keeping score. It's just not really properly resetting. So, and you know what? Having this thing in the garage, it really reminds me of camping as a kid. Because in the summer, I go to these campgrounds with these outdoor arcades. You know, they were like literally these like, tent pole buildings that were all open on the sides, and they would have this type of pinball machine in the campground when I was a kid, and having these sounds and being in the heat and all that, it just reminds me of camping. But anyway, today we're not going to work on the Bronco. That's going to come soon. I want to talk about the Mortal Kombat 2, and I want to get started on it this weekend just because the weather is so amazing. This is actually the best time of the year to work on these games. Late summer, early fall, you know, the humidity's low, the temperature's comfortable. So anyway, this is it. This is the Mortal Kombat 2. If you guys remember, we picked up this cabinet on Craigslist. It was empty. I paid $50 for it, and there was nothing, like literally nothing. And since then, I've managed to get all the parts. And I want to kind of talk about that today in the video and also get started on the control panel. But I definitely want to thank everyone that sent me the stuff, okay? Because you guys all freaking rule, so thank you. So when we got the game, we did not have a marquee, okay? And Jay Lumen on Claw sent me the marquee, and there it is. So thank you, Jay. And then the control panel. Well, I bought that, I actually paid for shipping from Josh Newman, and this I think is actually a pretty hard part to find, or expensive part, because it's a piece of wood here with this kind of galvanized metal over it, and then clear Plexi. So I got all three layers. This is an original Mortal Kombat control panel here, so that's freaking awesome. So thank you so much, man, because that's a tough part. So thanks, Joshua. And then over here, I got a bunch of stuff. So now Alex Smith, okay, in Australia, he sent me a PCB. And Alex, thank you so much. Actually, he sent me a note here. He says, good day, John. Hope this package finds you safe, mate. I've been throwing in all the extra board. Oh, he threw in an extra board. It's not safe for work. But hey, I thought it might be a laugh. Enjoy. And so he sent me a second PCB besides the Mortal Kombat. And I actually have no idea what this second PCB is at all. Here it is. So I think we'll do a video. It says here, Gun Dealer. So I don't know, is that the name of the game? So Alex Smith, thank you so much for the Mortal Kombat 2 PCB, and thank you for this mystery PCB. And we'll do a video of this. I don't know what it is. So I think it'd be kind of fun to do a video on this board. He says it's not safe for work, so who knows what we're getting into. So we'll do that later. And then, so since the last video, I went online and I ordered the joysticks and the buttons. Now, on eBay, okay, I bought a Mortal Kombat. Actually, it's a set that someone sells on eBay with like a bunch of buttons and two joysticks, and it's really inexpensive. So I got a bunch of the Happ Competition Buttons, I believe they're called, and these are the micro switch buttons that would have been on Mortal Kombat originally. And then it also came with some Happ Competition Joysticks, which are these guys right here, I believe. Let's see. You know, it's these ones. Okay, so this is the Happ Competition Joystick right here. Now, a lot of guys say that the Happ Competition Joysticks are garbage now, okay? And this is actually what they would have used back in the day. But however, Happ, I guess, was having these joysticks manufactured by another company, I think they're called IL, okay? And so Paradise Arcade sells the IL joysticks, which are supposed to be the exact same as the ones that were in Mortal Kombat. However, they're not labeled HAPP anymore because HAPP and this company had a falling out. So HAPP, I guess, moved this production to China or something and basically remade the joysticks. And these are more like the originals. Now, there's a couple different school of thoughts here with these joysticks. Some people think that the HAPP competitions are more forgiving and easier joysticks to operate. Because I guess with the ILs, they're too sensitive. And it's very easy to accidentally get kind of false directions on these. So what I'm going to do is Paradise Arcade sent me the ILs, okay? And then I also ordered the HAPPs. And so Paradise told me that, hey, man, you need to use my joysticks. You know, these ILs are way better than the Suzos, to the Suzo HAPP joysticks. So I'll send you the ILs and you try them out. And if you like them, pay for them. If not, send them back. So we're going to try both joysticks. That's my plan. I'm going to put like the HAPPs in player one and then the ILs in like player two. And then we'll see how we feel about the joysticks. And we're going to do like a true test. And maybe when we get the game going, I'll invite one of my hardcore fighter friends over, like my friend Ted, and him and I could put these through the paces because I'd like to get his opinion on them too. And then I picked up some random stuff here. I grabbed some of these screws. I guess these are original Midway or Williams screws that some guy bought like a giant box of them and put them on eBay, and he's been selling lots of like 100 of these. And these are kind of black security type screws. I believe that we need these for the control panel, so I bought a whole lot of those, like 100 of them. So that should last me a lifetime for these kind of Bally Midway projects. And then I went to Ace Hardware and picked up some screws to screw the joysticks to the control panel. And then over here, we've got these two boxes, okay? And my buddy Daniel, who absolutely rules, by the way. I mean, Daniel is amazing. Daniel's down in Georgia, and I love the guy. I love the guy to death. He sent me so much stuff over the past few years here, including some of the Tony Hawk skateboard decks in the basement. But anyway, Daniel had a Radical Bikers cabinet that was a junk game, and so he gave me a lot of the parts from that so we can complete the Mortal Kombat, because Radical Bikers was basically in a Mortal Kombat cabinet, so it shares a lot of the same parts. And so what we have in these two boxes should be everything else. And really, right now, I have every single Mortal Kombat 2 part, except for the side art and the glass, I believe. So let's open this up and see what's in here. And again, Daniel, thank you so much. So right here, that's the dollar bill, looks like, where, you know, because you could put dollar bills in the game and they would probably drop into this and then the operator would pull them out. So that's the dollar bill catcher. Let's see here. Here's a bunch of miscellaneous bolts. Oh, these are probably for the control panel. So those we'll definitely need, these little carriage bolts and nuts. Awesome. Thank you, Daniel. And then what else is in here? We have a coin bucket. Okay, one. And then this piece of metal here. I'm not sure what that does. We'll figure it out. It looks like this might be for the coin door. And then over here, some more metal. Oh, so that's the coin chute catcher. So all these parts I was missing. So, I mean, if it wasn't for Daniel, I don't know how I'd find this stuff. And here's the other coin bucket. So this is all the coin door stuff. And again, thanks, Daniel. And then let's look in this box right here. Okay, so here's another big beefy box full of fun. So let's see. And yes, you guys are all amazing. Thank you so much. This is gonna be fun, isn't it? All right, so what's in here? So we have a Louis Vuitton. Daniel, you shouldn't have. You sent me a purse. Maybe it's like a laptop bag or something. I could be really hip. Let's see what's in here. Okay, so in here, what's this? This is just some, well, there's something in here. Okay, so I think I know what this is. This should be the control panel overlay. And Daniel had this in his warehouse. I'm not sure where it's from. Is this a reproduction? I'm not sure, but I think we're gonna run with it. So Daniel, thanks, look at that. I believe this is a digital print, we'll see. So let's put this to the side. Okay, so what else is in here? Some more bolts. Again, I think these are for the control panel. Let's put those over there. And then in this bag, it looks like this is the harness. Yes, we are missing the harness, and Daniel had an extra Mortal Kombat 2 harness. Now, this is not from the Radical Bikers. So, awesome. We were missing that. Amazing, guys, right? Daniel, thank you. All right, let's go in the next box here, see what else we have. So right here, this big heavy thing, I know what this is. All right, so here is the transformer assembly right here. So this is our isolation transformer. That's basically gonna power the monitor and then, you know, the lights and everything else. So awesome. I mean, come on, how would I find that? I mean, honestly. All right, and then down here is the coin door, which again is really unique because see these buttons right here? This is how you basically get in the service menu and control everything. You know, this is very similar to what you'd find on Williams, like System 11 and newer pinball machines. So this is a, it says here Atari Games Core. Now, I guess the story with this is that, I'm gonna try to understand this properly. So Williams, Bally, or Midway, whatever, made a bunch of Mortal Kombat 4 cabinets and they were dogs, okay? And they sold them to Atari, I guess, to make Radical Bikers. But the guts in the cabinet were actually Mortal Kombat 4, and then they put their stuff in there. So it's the same Mortal Kombat cabinet, but they put Radical Bikers. And Radical Bikers was an Atari game that was you riding a bicycle like delivering pizzas, okay? But anyway, that's why it says Atari right here, but really, this is Williams through and through here. So this started out as Williams, and I don't know if I'm screwing up that story, but that's kind of the gist of it, that Mortal Kombat 4 was a real dog, or 3, or one of them, and so they made all these cabinets, and then they were converted to Radical Bikers, which was also a dog. Radical Bikers are on sale on Craigslist all the time, really cheap. So I believe that is everything. So let me clean this up, and then we're gonna get to work, guys. All right, we're all cleaned up here. And again, thank you, Daniel. Thank you, Alex Smith. Thank you, Joshua. Thank you, Jay Lumen. Is that everybody? I think so. And thanks, Paradise Arcade, for supplying those joysticks that we may or may not keep. Okay, so what are we gonna do in this video? I want to actually work on the control panel. I thought that'd be kind of a fun, light way to start this project. And so let's take off this tape here and just see what's going on with the control panel. And again, we got many layers here. We have a plywood base, a Plexi top, and then a metal plate in between. And so the overlay should attach directly to the metal, okay? And then the Plexi or Lexan should go over the top. And then the joysticks and buttons are gonna mount in between or through. So let's get this tape off here and take this whole thing apart and see what's going on. And I think this is all gonna make sense. So it's interesting, I'm looking here that there's these little nuts on there, and I'm wondering if that's what they used, or did they use those security screws? You see that right there? We've got these little nuts here, and it's my understanding that they use security screws on there, which makes more sense. And you can see it's got the little Midway serial tag right here. So this game came from game number 293316, and I'm curious to check my serial number. So that was 293316, and my game is 281016, I believe. Yeah, 281016. So this game, it was made a little bit sooner than the control panel we're using, but who cares, right? So, all right, let's take this tape off, and let's just kind of, I guess, let me get a nut driver here, and let's, this is all on there hand tight, actually. This is actually in really good shape. All right, so let's take all this off. So I'm gonna go ahead and just remove all of these and see how this comes off. So let me just unscrew those and then I'll come back. All right, I removed all of the little lock nuts that were on the back, and I'm just keeping everything in a bowl here as we go so I can keep track of all my pieces and parts. So let's get these guys off. Okay, so let's get all these little screws off of here. And then after we do that, everything should just kind of come apart into three pieces. All Okay, and Plexi's coming off now. Okay, so here's our piece of Plexi or Lexan, okay? So let's put this to the side. And then we have our piece of metal, which is where we're gonna apply our overlay. We're gonna apply this on here directly. Okay, so I see. So this piece of zinc here, or galvanized, has threaded studs that are mounted to it. So I think that I'm gonna keep it right now on the piece of wood because I think it'll be easier to work with. Now let's clean this up a little bit with some rapidtac. What I wanna do is, so we're gonna apply this overlay on here, but the buttonholes are not cut out, okay? And this is gonna be kinda tough to line up. So what I wanna do is I wanna just cut out a couple of buttonholes, like this one and this one, and then we're gonna put the buttons through so that when we, and I'm gonna just carefully come in here by hand and just kinda remove this hole right here with an X-Acto, okay? And then I'm gonna use this as a guide to line everything up. And there's a bit of a tolerance here, so I don't have to be exactly right on the money because the button has a collar that's gonna kinda hold, which is gonna cover up my sloppiness if there's any. So let's just kinda come through here and pop this out. So I don't know who made this reproduction. I don't know if this is a quality reproduction, but I kinda wanna do this restore on the cheap, and this looks pretty presentable. And you know, the Plexi goes over it, so I think we'll be just fine. So let's then come and cut this one out too. Just kind of coming through with my X-Acto and just doing this by hand, by eye. And I think as long as I'm relatively good here, relatively close, we'll be okay. Okay, so there's that. So why don't I get a button here and I'll show you what we're gonna do. Actually, I'm gonna clean it up first. Let's clean the metal up, the galvanized up. And I'm gonna use some rapidtac. And I think we're gonna apply this with the wet method. And so I use rapidtac, which is a cleaner and application fluid. It is made to put vinyl decals on. That's what this stuff is for. It's for I think the automotive guys use this quite a bit, you know, to do those vinyl decals and lines and stuff that you see on cars. So where are my paper towels? All right, so I'm gonna come in here. We're gonna just clean this up with this stuff. That way we have a nice clean surface that we're adhering this decal to. Pretty amazing how good this is, the shape of this piece of metal here. So Joshua, man, thanks for selling me this, bro, because this is fantastic. It's already stripped. All right, so we're nice and clean there. So let me get a couple buttons. And we'll just grab two buttons here, and we're gonna put those in our control panel to hold our overlay in place. So if we come here, and if I line this up like so, so we'll put that one there, and then I'll put one over here, and then we'll use this to get everything started, right? Because then if these two corners are lined up, then we can assume that everything else is lined up, right? So I'm gonna come in the back here, and let's just apply the collar. I'll show you guys what I'm doing here. So if we look on the back, trying to do this without destroying stuff. Let me get this tightened down here by hand. So I'm basically just tightening the collar on the back to hold this button in place. And it just doesn't want to go. There it goes. There, so I tightened the plastic collar. So let's take a look here on the back. As you can see that, we're nice and tight there. And then let's go do the same with this one. Seems kind of easy to misthread this. So the joystick hole, I could see there that we're gonna wanna really cut that one nice. Cause we'll be able to see the edge on that. It's not gonna be hidden by a collar with the button collar. Okay, so it's on, all right? And we can assume now it's in the right spot. So we're gonna go ahead and start on the left side. So let me get my squeegee. All right, actually, let's do it on this table here. Give us some room to work with here. Okay, so what we're gonna do is we're gonna start here on this side, okay? And I'm gonna peel this back. Hopefully this works out okay. All right, so let's peel this back like so. And we'll try not to kink this too badly here. Okay. Okay, so let's go as far back as we can. And then I'm gonna take my scissors here, and I'm gonna cut the wax paper off. Try to steer clear of the label. Try not to kink it. Ah, these scissors are horrible. Okay, so what we're gonna do now is I'm gonna spray some rapidtac on here. And then we're gonna take our squeegee and with a light touch here, just gonna squeegee it on. This adhesive isn't too hot, is it? There we go. Okay. And so the rapidtac is supposed to help us with air bubbles and all that good stuff, so. And we're basically just pushing the rapidtac out. All right. So I think that's pretty okay. So now we can remove this button. Actually, we're gonna have to remove both of the buttons here. So let's take this one out. And I really hope that this adhesive is such that it's holding well. And let's come over here and take this button out. Okay. All right, so let's come back like this, okay? And now we're gonna do the rest of it. So let's pull this back. Get this started here. This is a little hairy. I only get one shot, guys. Come on, get off. There's a piece of paper here. There we go. So it looks like some of the wax paper is coming off, like where we cut it. Try to get all this off of here. All right. Okay, so let's go ahead and spray this whole thing down. All right, here we go. I'm gonna take my squeegee, and I'm just gonna, with a light touch, just sort of go across. You guys can see what's going on here. I think this is gonna work out just fine. You know, I don't know how good this reproduction is. Is it good? I have no idea. It looks okay, I guess. I kind of get the sense that it's maybe a not quite amazing scan, and who knows if the font is right. Like for start, it looks like that's a new graphic design element that someone added, but you know, I'm trying to do this on the cheap, this restore, so this really fits the bill here. Thank you, Daniel. All right, so we're on. What's down here? Why is it not? What am I hitting here? All right, I think that looks pretty good. So now we gotta trim it down. and trim it to size, which I don't think is going to be too bad. And then we got to cut out all the holes for the buttons and the joystick. And then also, we need to find the holes for the, well, actually, when we go through the Plexi, I think we'll find all those right, those holes. Okay, so there's that. So let me grab an X-Acto blade and let's trim it to size. So I'm wondering the best way to handle this. I guess we'll just come in here. So let's just cut this to that and then go straight down like so. Okay. That looks pretty good, guys. It really does, actually. Now let's come over here and do the same. So this side's a little short, huh? We got a little bit of a white edge on this side. That kind of sucks. And then let's come up here. Just wasn't enough bleed on that side, huh? What are we hitting here? Let me move this over here. Okay. This is going okay. Come on, let's trim this. All right. Let's do this side real quick. Yeah, there's hardly any bleed on this left and right. This side is pretty much like right on the line and the other side is not. Okay, so let's kind of take a look here. This is a little sloppy, this edge back here. I'm gonna come in here and just try to clean this up. It's like the X-Acto is kind of digging into the wood. Oh, it's metal actually right here. There we go. Just gotta ride the metal. Okay, so let me get my squeegee and let's really try to get all this liquid out of here. All right, so I'm just kind of coming in and I'm just trying to push all the liquid out of this thing. I think we did a pretty good job putting this on though. There's no bubbles or kinks or anything. It's just that I don't get the sense the adhesive on this thing is super sticky. So I want to really make sure I get all the liquid out. I think this is going to look pretty good. When we put the Plexi over it, it's going to really make this look pro. I think that looks pretty good. All right, what do you guys think, huh? Did I do okay? Now we gotta cut out the buttonholes. But I think that looks pretty tight. So let's kinda come in here and just pop these out. And we'll see how close we are. God, these are not really lined up at all. They're in the ballpark, but not really exact. Huh. Thin stuff, guys. Let's see. Alright, so I'm gonna keep going here. I'm gonna cut all these holes out with my X-Acto, just like I did those ones, and we'll come back. Alright, guys, I got all the buttonholes cut out, and I think it looks okay. So let's kind of pop this off And let's take a look here. And I think I'm gonna take my X-Acto blade and just really, I should have actually did this initially, just cut it like this. Maybe not, can't seem to get this. I'm just kind of cleaning up the edges, fine tuning them a little bit. And I think it's okay. Like up here, it's not perfect. It's close. And it'll probably be fine, but I'm just seeing if I can improve it a little bit. I'm kind of hacking it up here. All right, let's take a look. I think it looks pretty good. I think it'll be just fine. Let's see, that looks good. These edges are all good. I'm not really seeing any bubbles. And I think when we put the Plexi over this, it's gonna really pop. And it's gonna really kind of hold it down and just make it look pro. Okay, so that's all out. So now we need to just really start populating this. The first thing I do need to do is I need to put the dust washers in. And because the dust washers go under the metal, okay? And we can't forget to do this. So we're gonna drop them in here. So I'm gonna put the Happ Competition on player one, okay? And then we'll put the IL on player two. I think that's the plan. Let me just dry this off. So let's drop our, so here's the IL. What stinks though is I'm gonna have to take this apart once I decide which one to go with. Okay, so here's the IL. Okay, so the IL, you'll notice that the actuator is really large, and on the Happ, it's not. Let's see, the Happ actuator is weird. It's right here. It's a different kind of material. It might be the same size, let's see. Yeah, it's the same size. It's a different type of material. This is some kind of nylon or something. This is a harder plastic, like ABS or something. So I'm not sure if that affects the feel of it or what. But so we're gonna have to pull the E-clip off of here, the C-clip, so we can get the dust washer off, because the ILs come assembled and the Happs come unassembled. So let me get some pliers here. All right, so let's pull this off of here. Boy, that is tight. Just trying to get my pliers underneath this. There we go. Let's see if we can get that. Man, that's really on there. Let me get a tiny screwdriver. Maybe that'll be easier just to kind of get it started. Let's try a little jeweler's screwdriver. And we'll see if we can just kind of come in here and get it started. Boy, that's on there. Okay, it's started. Let's see if we can grab it with the pliers now. There we go. Okay, so I'm guessing this is gonna explode when we get this off. All right, so let's pull this out. Okay, you can see how there's a white collar there and then the dust washer. Now these by default come with red dust washers, and I actually asked them to send me black because Mortal Kombat originally had black dust washers, and you'll be able to see the dust washers. So I didn't want red dust washers, so I asked him to put black ones in there, and he did, so thank you. Okay, so our dust washers are in, so we should be able now to drop this in and really just start assembling this. So let's kind of come in here and line this up. Okay. And I think I could put the lock washers back on. Is there any reason why I can't? I don't think so. So let's put the lock washers back on. And secure this. Now over here, I believe there's some hardware that I'm missing. for the lockdown. Yeah, I am missing this hardware. I wonder if Daniel somehow included that. So I'm missing the hardware to lock down the control panel to the cabinet. Yeah, I don't have it, so I'll have to look out for that stuff. That's just like a little angle bracket that goes here and here. So if you guys have that, let me know. That's the kind of stuff like you could find at Arcade Boneyard. He always has random parts like that. So I'll have to go on arcadeboneyard.com. And I know, we were talking about Arcade Boneyard on the podcast, and Joe's like, I don't think that's someone we should support. And I don't know. I mean, he is definitely parting out cabinets, but we don't know the condition of these cabinets. And, you know, when I was working on my track and field, I got a Hyper Sports control panel from him. And I think the overlay that was on it was like 1943 or some random, you know, generic JAMA game. And so that Hyper Sports was dead, and that control panel saved my track and field. So I don't know. You tell me. I think he sells the games when they're good. I don't think he destroys all of them. I don't think he takes a good working complete game and parts it out. At least that's what I want to believe. All right, so those are all on there. We'll just put them on hand tight for now. Okay, so now we can start putting stuff on. And actually, we got to put the Plexi on first. So let's do that. So let's grab the Plexi and line it up. And I think I'll put some buttons in. Yeah, I think we'll put the screws in. Boy, that looks pretty sharp, huh? This is gonna look really good, actually. I should probably clean the Plexi. So let's clean one side of it with some Windex and paper towel and make sure that's nice and clean and smudge-free before we commit it to the control panel. I'm looking for my Windex. All right, I'm just gonna come over here away from the overlay and we'll spray this down. So this is gonna go on there like, you know, it goes on like this. So this is the bottom right here. So let's clean the bottom real nice. This is in pretty decent shape. It's original. You can buy reproductions of the control panel, the metal, and the Plexi on eBay. There's a guy selling them. But that whole setup would have cost me, I don't know, $150 or something like that. And Josh sold this to me for $60 shipped, which I think is great. All right. So let's just get all of our fingerprints off of this side. Okay, and then let's line this up with the cabinet. I mean, with the control panel, like so, okay. And then let's drop a couple buttons in. Now, actually, I need to go look online really quick to see what buttons go where, because there's red, white, and blue buttons for Mortal Kombat. So let's Google Mortal Kombat control panel. See what comes up on Google Images here. Actually, we want Mortal Kombat 2 control panel. So let's go Mortal Kombat 2 control panel. And we've got all kinds of images here. So let's make sure that we're seeing a constant pattern, and we are. Okay, so the start buttons are white. Okay, so here's our image. So the start buttons are white, and then left to right goes red, white, and blue. Okay, so that's one image right there. Let's look at some more images. Yeah, that's definitely the order here. So the start buttons are white, and then it goes red, white, blue for each player. And I'm just looking at a whole bunch of images here. Yeah, everyone, they're all the same. Start are white, and then the blocks are white, and then red, white, blue. Okay, so let's drop a white in here, like so. And we'll tighten this up by hand. You know, I forgot who it was, but one of my viewers sent me a wrench. I gotta find that right now. We'll pull that out. He sent me a wrench for buttons, and I never used it. We should see if we can find that. It should be my toolbox. Let's tighten this up. All right. Boy, that looks pretty good. What do you guys think, huh? That looks tight, right? So let's grab some more buttons. Here's white. So white goes in the middle. Oh, that doesn't want to go in. Okay. Let's tighten that up. And let's do the other white middle one. Now these don't have the micro switches in them. We're gonna have to add the micro switches. So after I put all the buttons on, we will grab the micro switches and insert them into each of the buttons. All right, so these are red and red. Okay. Tighten the collar up. Okay. How's it looking, guys? I think it looks pretty good. Red and red. Okay. Get a couple collars here. Alright. And then it's going to go blue, 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 blue. Blue and blue. And then this attaches to that hinge somehow. Oh, I see. So these are going to go into the hinge, the four. So we're going to have to undo this, I think. Because this control panel is hinged. All right, let's put the last two blues and then we're done with the buttons and we can drop the joysticks in. So our overlay, you know, is not lined up perfect, but it's funny. Because you can see some of the white around these buttons. I don't know. I'm not going to worry about it, but it's not perfect. I don't know if I should have used more buttons when I lined it up. All right, so those are all on hand tight. Okay, so let's put our joysticks on. Actually, I'm going to look for that button wrench. I'd like to use that right now. I'm curious to see how it works. Let me see if I can find it in my toolbox. Okay, I found the wrench. So this is called Bit Wrench, and there's a guy named Glitch who sells these on Clove and I think eBay, and he saw in one of my videos me trying to tighten up the PAL nuts on the back of the buttons with channel locks. And so he said, John, you need this wrench. So he sent me one, and so I've yet to use it because I just haven't had the project. So let's give it a shot here. So let's kind of come in. Oh yeah, look at that, huh? So, actually works pretty well. So we'll come in here and just tighten these up. And I'm not gonna go crazy because this is plastic. But yeah, that's great. And normally I would take my channel locks. Let's see if we come in like from the top. No, that doesn't work. All right, so go like that. This one's a little tight, but we can get to it. And it looks like it's for two different size PAL nuts. Maybe this is for Leafs buttons. I think it is. So let's tighten these all down with our bit wrench. Yeah, that works pretty great. So I saw that he was selling these on eBay, and he also sells them on Clove, and it's called Bit Wrench, and that's one word. So okay, so our buttons are all tight. So thanks again, Glitch. That's a pretty cool tool. So let's go ahead and throw the micro switches on here. So these are micro switch buttons. They're not leaf switches. You know, most of the stuff in the 80s, we usually deal with leaf switches, you know, where you have two contacts that come together, you know, like the Quantum and pretty much most of our restores, you know, they just have, I'm trying to see if I can find a leaf switch button to show you the difference. But so these buttons here are micro switch buttons and they're little tiny mechanical switches. right here, and so when you push the button, it engages this switch. And these, I believe, are like cherry switches. Is this kind of the same button that's in a mechanical keyboard? I'm not really sure, but it has that kind of mechanical keyboard feedback, you know, that kind of clicky sound. So some people like these, some people don't. I think leaf switches are better, but these are definitely more period correct, because this is what would have been in this game. So we want to use these. So to put these in, it's pretty simple. And if you ever have to replace a leaf switch, with a micro switch, which I have, because I had one like die on my Neo Geo. So it's pretty simple to replace these. And there's like a little tab on the back here. And actually, put that way. So the little button part needs to go down, and you just kind of come in here, just snap it on like so. So just make sure the little red actuator is pointing down like so. And you just kind of start one corner. And let's see here. Why is this not making sense? Here it is. Like so. So I'm gonna go ahead and just put all these leaf switches in, and then we'll come back. All right, I have all the micro switches in, not leaf switches, micro switches. So, and if we come here to test them, we can hear them engaging and clicking. So that's all good. Okay, so let's put our joysticks in, okay? And again, I wanna put the IL on player 2 and the HAPP on player 1. Now, I was missing the hardware to mount these joysticks, and I believe I bought the right stuff. I took the control panel to Ace Hardware, and so basically there's some T-nuts in here, and they're 8/32 screws, 8/32 screws, and so that's what I bought. And they're machine screws, and I bought lock washers and washers, and we're going to secure the joysticks using all of that. So let's turn this over, and I'll show you guys what I'm talking about. So I guess we'll do the, let's do this one first, actually. So where did I put that C-clip? I hope I don't lose that. Where's the C-clip? Oh, here it is. Let's put that in my bowl. All right, so let's secure the base here. And I don't think it should matter which way we put this on. Okay, so it's gonna go like this. And then inside here is, again, there's some 8/32 threaded T-nuts. And so I bought some 8/32 machine screws, washers and lock washers. And so basically what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put this on with the screw and then a lock washer and then a washer. And I'm totally guessing that that's what was in here, but it's gotta be. And we'll just kinda put this in here and get that started. And then, and I definitely feel strongly about using the lock washer, because it's gonna be super tight and we don't want the joysticks moving around. So let's kinda come in here. There we go. Looks good. So let's take our lock washer and our washer and put this on here. Okay, and then I'll do the last one with you guys on this side, and I'll do the other one. Okay, so that's on there really good. So, all right, I'm gonna go ahead and put the HAPP on, which is the same way. Yeah, this is the HAPP one, right? I don't wanna get these confused. Yes, it is. Yeah, the HAPP has white micro switches, and then the IL has black. So I'm gonna put the HAPP on the same way, and we'll come back. Okay, I have all 8 of them on. I'm just gonna come in with a manual screwdriver and just really snug these up, because the electric one is a bit overpowered. But, you know, with the lock washer, it's really snug. And by the way, these are 8/32 machine screws, and they're 1 inch long. And I took the whole thing to Ace Hardware, and we tried the different lengths to see how far down they would go, making sure that this was tight and not too loose, and it's the 1 inch is what you need. Okay, so let's go ahead and put the joysticks on, and we're gonna come from the top, go right through the dust washer, just like so, and now I gotta put the clip on, which is probably gonna be tricky here. All right, so let's kind of push this down, and we're gonna try to get this on. I'm just gonna try to get it started. It's not too bad, actually. I'm coming with my pliers. There we go. Okay, so that one's in. And then let's do the same for the HAPP. Now, the HAPP came with a bag of parts. So we need the actuator, like that, the black one there. We're gonna drop that in. So you could see, I dropped the little actuator in. Okay, like so. And then there should be an E-clip and maybe a collar here. Actually, let's look at the instructions here. So it goes shaft, cylinder, actuator, and then E-ring. So where's my little bag of parts that came with this joystick? Here it is. Okay, so we need this collar. That's gonna go through the joystick like this, okay? And then we're gonna need the clip. Let's put the joystick through here. Okay. And then we need to put our E-ring on. Same way we did the other side. So I'm gonna push down here and then come in with some pliers, like so. Gotta get pressure off it. Okay, it's in. All right, so let's take a look here. How do we do? Looks legit, right? Boy, these really do feel different. Holy cow. I could tell you right now that the HAPP is, it's stiffer, okay? This is the sense I'm getting. Now, we haven't played the game yet, so I have no idea, but this, I could tell, is a little more positive, like when I'm going in the direction, okay? I could feel distinct, like clicks kind of from switch to switch, whereas this is super loose. This is very sensitive. This has a more of a firm feel, and this just feels like it's loose and it can go 360 degrees. Whereas this kind of feels more like an 8-way. Interesting. There's definitely a distinct feel that's going on there, guys. All right, so let's put this on the control panel and take a look here how it looks. And also, I want to just maybe attach this to the hinge right here. Looks like we just need those four screws. Okay, so that's that. How's it look, guys? So we're going to have to put some T-molding. I think that looks pretty okay. We have this white edge here, which is a bit of a bummer, and it's not my fault. That artwork was not quite the full width. But you know what I should have done? I should have taken a Sharpie and just went boop down the edge. I don't know, maybe we can do that later. I'm kind of thinking I want to throw those security screws in here real quick, just to screw the Plexi down. Let me grab the security screws in a bit, and I think it will really kind of finish off the look here. So I'm gonna use these again. I got these on eBay, and they're Torque security screws, black with a washer, and I'm pretty sure that this is what was used originally on this game. And like I said, there was a guy on eBay, he had a picture of the box, and it was like a box from the 90s, and it said, like, you know, security torque screws or something, and it was stamped Williams, and, you know, Bally, Midway, and Williams was all the same company back then. So let me get some security bits here. And I believe, let's see, is it this one right here? Yeah, it is. So it's this bit we're gonna need. Okay, let's just double check. Yep. And we'll just kind of come in here with our screwdriver, screw these down. Hopefully all my screw holes line up. And we don't want to go too tight here because we could crack the Plexi, I think, pretty easily, don't you think? So let's kind of come in here, just kind of see if this goes in. And this screwdriver is so underpowered. I think that looks pretty legit. So let's grab some more. I don't want to go too tight on that. Yeah, let's come to this side. So the screw holes are really lining up here, which kind of tells me, I don't know. What am I saying? Doesn't tell me anything. I was going to say it tells me that the overlay was on right, but that doesn't tell me that at all because the Plexi and the metal is always going to line up because that's how it was. Boy, that looks good, guys. This is feeling like a Mortal Kombat here. You know, the next video, what do you guys want to do? I'm thinking about maybe attacking the monitor. I mean, we're going to have to restore the cabinet. I mean, that's kind of part of the game plan here, but I don't know what, if I want to start the cabinet first or the electronics. I'm really tempted to get the game working and just kind of get that behind me. You guys have a thought of, you know, what we should do next? Should we, do you guys want to do the cabinet first or do you want to get the game working fully first? Put the harness on. I have a 25-inch monitor on the shelf over there, which is dead. So do we want to work on that next and get the monitor working, get that behind us, put the harness in, put the board in, and play us some Mortal Kombat, and then make the cabinet look really pretty? What do you guys think? So, all right, let's take a look at this, by the way. I think this looks great. I think for a... You know, this reproduction, I don't think is the highest quality. I don't. But the price was right. And again, thank you, Daniel. You know, if I were to buy this control panel overlay, I would go to Rich at This Old Game because I know the quality is going to be superb. But I don't think that looks too bad. And because it's underneath the Plexi, the material and all that isn't very important, I don't think. So that looks good. That looks legit. You guys like it? We could try doing the hinge. I'm not sure what's involved with that. So I think all I need to do is get some washers. Do these line up here? I'm trying to line this up. And we're missing that hardware. So I think these four screws here should line up to the hinge. Right? Yeah, it does. Barely though. There, like so. Yeah, let's do that. Let me take those off and we'll screw this to the hinge. We really should get a washer. I don't know. It looks like there wasn't a washer actually. I could tell because of the, you could see the lock washer marks on the hinge. And we're gonna have to get some T-molding because there's supposed to be T-molding on this, the edge of this control panel, which is really gonna finish it off. All right, so let's kind of come in here and see if we can do this. It's a little awkward. There. And then let's tighten these up. One. And then there's a chain. See this chain here? That's supposed to screw to the control panel so that it can't open all the way. I guess we can attach that really quick. All right, so that's in. Let's see how this works. Let me get a socket here and we'll tighten that hinge down. All right, I'm gonna come in with a socket and tighten all these nuts down. Hopefully I can do this without a deep socket. Okay, and then this one here was missing the lock washer, so I'm going to relocate this one. And use a nut that has the lock washer on the hinge. It's a little more critical, I think. Alright, let's tighten this down. Okay, so that looks pretty legit, right? And then we have that chain, and I can see where that goes, okay? So the chain is gonna screw to this hole right here, right? Sure looks like it. Or is it this hole? Could go to either one. Let's try this one. Oh, that's a nut too. Get a nut driver for that. Is it this? No. Let me find the right nut driver here, and we'll tighten this guy down in here. Does it go here or here? This seems more logical to me. All right, let me find a nut driver, and we'll tighten that chain down. Okay, so let's tighten that down. Okay. Boy, that looks good. What do you guys think, huh? How do we do? That looks legit, right? So we're missing these brackets so that we can close this and lock it down. So we're gonna have to keep our eyes out for those or just come up with something with an angle iron bracket or something. I think this looks pretty okay. You know, I think it looks decent. What do you guys think? How did we do? We gotta get some T-molding here. And when we replace all the T-molding, we'll take care of that. But this looks and feels good. Yeah. So guys, we're gonna stop here. What do you think? How was that? How did we do for our first Mortal Kombat 2 video? So we put the overlay on, we got the buttons and the joysticks on, we got two kinds of joysticks. We got the Happ Competition and the IL joysticks from Paradise Arcade. We have our Happ buttons in there, the micro switch buttons. We did the right colors, you know, white for the start, and then red, white, and blue, red, white, and blue. We got a reproduction overlay, which I think looks pretty decent. Again, I wish the bleed extended a little further left and right, but hey, Daniel, thank you. The price was right, so I'm not gonna complain. I think for what we have into it, it looks pretty good. So guys, this is starting to look like a Mortal Kombat. What do you think here, huh? We got the marquee from Jay Lumen, thank you. Now the side art, I don't know if you guys missed the unlisted video that I did, but I actually used some alcohol, and I guess we could do this a little bit, but boy, this is messy, let me tell you. I used some alcohol and magic eraser, okay, which there was a guy that did a video on YouTube. I don't know his username, but he showed a video removing paint off of side art using alcohol, isopropyl alcohol 91%, and a magic eraser, okay? These two things. And you know, he didn't use citrus strip or paint stripper or anything like that. He just used alcohol and a magic eraser, and he was magically removing artwork from a bubbles cabinet. And I saw that video, I'm like, holy cow, because someone sent me a link. So I tried it, okay? And I think it's a very safe way to remove paint, and I guess we'll do some of it right now. This, I'm telling you right now though, this is beyond messy. Like I'm super duper duper messy here. So I'm gonna go ahead and soak my magic eraser in alcohol, and I'm telling you, I cannot explain to you how messy this is. You are going to be covered in black, okay? So don't have a good watch on or jewelry or any of that. And the last time I did this, my entire arm was black. All this stuff was black. So I'm going to try to just do this in a way where I don't get all my stuff dirty. And I'm definitely not going to use this hand with my white watch. So, but let me show you. So you just kind of come in here and you just go like this, right? With the alcohol and the magic eraser, and it takes some elbow grease. Okay, but the paint just starts magically coming off, okay? Look at this, just, it is like freaking magic. It's a lot of work, but it's magic. Like seriously, and look at that. Isn't that amazing? But what this is proving though, is that the artwork underneath my paint is hosed. I think that the operator sanded the cabinet down and then painted it. That's what I think happened here. And it's a shame because the artwork's gone. It's lost forever. And I know that you guys thought that I was doing the damage to the artwork when we tried stripping it last time with the citrus strip, and that's just not the case. The operator sanded this down. And if you look up here in the top left, and by the way, wasn't that just amazing what would just happen there with a magic eraser and some alcohol? So that's really a very safe way to remove paint. So I'm personally going to always do it this way going forward. If this doesn't work, then you might have to go to some stronger stripper. But this is magic. I mean, it's a pain in the butt. It's a lot of work. But wow, it's a very safe way to remove paint because you're not touching the artwork at all. It's just really, really messy. So anyway, you can see up here in the top where I did it, the M in Mortal Kombat is just blown out. And again, I don't know what the operator did, so he must have sanded the cabinet before he painted it. And just keep going here. I know, this is like magic, isn't it? This shouldn't work. Well, how is this working? How is alcohol removing paint? It just doesn't make any sense. And you can see the artwork is just gone. Look at it. It's just gone. So I don't know what happened. That's just a real bummer because I was really hoping we would save that artwork, and there's just no way. And you know, that's adding $200 to the restore because the artwork is $200 for the sides. And so I'm gonna have to bite the bullet, I think. You know, I'm not gonna lie, I kind of thought to myself, you know, maybe we'll strip it all down and see what it looks like. And if you can kind of tell it's Mortal Kombat, if you squint at it, maybe I'll just live with it. Or do we spend the $200 and get the right artwork? I don't know, what do you guys think? That would be wrong, right? We can't do that. So, I wanna kill that operator that did that, don't you? Why would you do that? So, anyway, all right, guys, that's going to do it for the Mortal Kombat 2 restore part number one. And how did we do? Our next video, I don't know, what do you want to do? I'm wondering, do we work on the monitor? I kind of want to get the monitor over with because that monitor's dead. And I suppose we could test the monitor in the Xenophobe or the Pole Position 2 to make sure that we fixed it. We definitely can do that. So next video, we got to figure out what's wrong with the 25-inch monitor because I have a spare 25-inch monitor down there, right there. And that's the monitor we're going to put in this game because originally had a 25-inch, like K7000 standard resolution monitor. And thankfully, I have a spare one. And the one that's on my shelf was actually in my Street Fighter. But it died at a party, and I swapped it with another monitor I had in the garage. So the one that's on the shelf was actually in the Street Fighter, and it died at a party. It just went black. So I don't know if the flyback went or the hot or what, but I'm guessing it's going to be a simple fix. But I just kind of want to shotgun the whole thing, maybe do a cap kit, flyback, and hot, and just really start fresh with it. So anyway, yes, guys, that's it for this video. Hope you enjoyed it. Why don't we go back down in the basement and do some viewer mail. But I think we did a good job. I think that control panel looks legit. You know, this is kind of a bummer. Maybe next time I take the Plexi off, which I'm going to have to do. No, I don't have to do that to swap the joysticks, do I? If I want to change the dust washer, but I really should have taken a Sharpie and just drew a black, just covered the white with a black Sharpie, but whatever. It looks okay. So, all right, guys, that's it. Let's go back down to the basement and do some viewer mail. All right, guys, there you have it. That was part number one of the Mortal Kombat restoration. So what'd you guys think, huh? The control panel looks decent, doesn't it? The with the buttons on and the Plexi and all that good stuff. So I think it looks pretty sharp. So I need to thank everyone that helped me get all of those parts because you guys are amazing. So, you know, let me see if I can do this off the top of my head. So Jay Lumen got me the marquee, is that right? And then Joshua sent me the control panel. I bought that from him, 60 shipped. So Alex Smith down in Australia sent me the PCB. My God, thank you very much. And of course, my good friend Daniel sent me the rest. You know, the control panel overlay, the transformer, the coin door, the harness. So we have everything to put this thing together. And I'm kind of jazzed. I'm starting to picture what it's going to be like with Mortal Kombat down here. Where's it going to go? So, I'm kind of plotting, and I don't know if we can do this, but I'm kind of thinking that somehow I keep the Tempest down here and I find a new home for it, okay? And then that back wall over there where Golden Tee is and Firefox and ice cold beer and all that, maybe I can somehow tighten that up and open up a large enough space after Tempest leaves to slide the Mortal Kombat in, and then somehow squeeze the Tempest into some hole somewhere down here. I know it's probably crazy talk because there really are no holes, so I don't know, but anyway, I'm excited that at least we accomplished something with the Mortal Kombat, and I think the next video, unless you guys disagree, I think we should start the monitor. Let's rebuild that monitor, let's get that working, and then after that, we just put the thing together with the harness and the power supply. Actually, I need to order a power supply. That just uses a switching power supply, because Daniel sent me the transformer, not a power supply, and Mortal Kombat just uses your typical, you know, HAPP, or Suzo HAPP power supply, you know, or Peter Chow or whatever. So I'll order one of those and we'll put that in. So anyway, yes, that was the Mortal Kombat. And so if you guys noticed, this video is out early on Sunday and I did this on purpose. So I have time Sunday now to edit. Instead of going to the garage on Sunday, which is what I want to do, we're going to, hang on, the TV came on here. Wait, hang on, quiet. So Sunday, I'm gonna spend some time editing the on the road videos. So I wanted to get this out early Sunday. That's the plan. So I spent Saturday working in the garage because the weather was nice, and then Sunday we'll start editing some of the on the road videos and start pushing those out. Hopefully mid next week. So anyway, let's do viewer mail. Actually, before we do that, I want to thank somebody. So Scott Washburn sent me a package and a letter here. It says, "Hi John. Here is the Vegetti for the As Seen on John's Kitchen viewer mail giveaway that I emailed you about." So Scott sent me one of these. Okay. Now, if you guys remember, we did a John's Kitchen a couple years ago on April Fool's, and we made low carb pasta. It was Sunday spaghetti gravy, and I used one of these to make some zucchini noodles. And so I'm gonna be giving this away. Actually, I want to do a giveaway soon, like a John's Arcade prize package again, and I'll be announcing that in the next week here. We're gonna give away this, a kill screen CD, t-shirts, etc. I'll put together a whole little prize package, but Scott wanted to donate one of these to give away, and I think it's hilarious. And maybe I'll autograph it. Would you like an autographed Vegetti? And if you missed my John's Kitchen video, go back and watch that. You can see how I used it. He goes on, "I ran across the Firefox DVD on Friday at a local thrift store. I thought you might want the movie since you have the game, or feel free to keep the DVD or give it away as well, whichever you want. Have a great day and get back to making videos." Scott Washburn, he says, "Did you ever send out the trading card?" No, I didn't actually. Oh my God, I totally forgot about that. John needs a secretary. I have a bunch of people that are waiting for trading cards. I said I'd mail you guys those. I gotta try to do that in the next week here. I actually totally forgot about that until I just read this email. I will do that. I'll actually include the trading cards in my little giveaway, but I have about 10, 15 people that I did a little contest, or I said like the first 10 people to email me, I give you one of my Twin Galaxies or Walter Day trading cards. But anyway, Scott, thank you for this stuff. I actually am very happy you sent me this. This was the perfect thing to send me because, well, we finished the Firefox restore and the game's down here. And of course the game is based on this movie, right? With Clint Eastwood. And I've been wanting to watch this movie. And I was gonna rent it like on Netflix or something, or on Amazon. I guess you wouldn't rent on Netflix. I don't think the movie's on Netflix, but I was gonna rent it on like Amazon or what have you. Cause I really wanna watch Firefox again. Cause I haven't seen this since I was a kid. And you know, I got the game down here. So I'm gonna watch this, absolutely. So Scott, this was the perfect thing to send me. So thanks. All right, let's do some viewer mail. If you guys want to participate in the viewer mail, you need to email them to me at blkdog7@gmail.com. That's blkdog7@gmail.com. My table is getting smaller, it feels like. All right, so yeah, again, blkdog7@gmail.com. In the subject line, you got to put viewer mail. First one here is from Brian. Hey, John, I was wondering if there are any tips on starting my own arcade. Two more questions are, when did you start your arcade, and what was your first arcade machine? Anyways, great videos, John. Keep up the great work on them. From your viewer, Ricky. His name says Brian. Weird. All right, Ricky. So I guess are you using your dad's email, Ricky? Okay, so Ricky wants to know tips on my own arcade, and when did you start, and what was your first? Well, okay, we'll come over here. So the first game I ever got was Donkey Kong, and it's right here. And we've talked a lot about it on this channel, but If you haven't seen all my videos, you might not know that. So this was the first game I ever picked up. I bought this on eBay. I paid a lot of money for it. I overpaid, really. I love it. It's my favorite game of all time. It's the first game I got. I've had it, I guess, for... How long have I been doing this? 8 years? Something like that. So I've been doing this for 8 years. I've been collecting these games for 8 years, and this was the first one I got, okay? And it is my favorite game. It's still my favorite game. It will always be my favorite game. And so as far as tips, you know, this is something that I get asked a lot, and I probably should do a dedicated video to this. But at the end of the day, it comes down to getting your hands dirty, being persistent, looking on Craigslist every day. Craigslist is where the deals are. That's where you're gonna find the broken stuff, okay? You wanna find the person who somehow has one arcade game, okay? And the person has had this game for 20 years, they're not a collector, they're not a hobbyist. Somehow they inherited this game, it's in their garage, it's in their basement, it's been in their laundry room for 10 years. Those are the deals that you're looking for, you know? And you know, I look at the games I picked up in the last year or two here, and I got a lot of those games. You know, the Firefox was one of those games. The guy had one game. He had it for 15 years. Who knows why? What, you know? So you want to find that guy, okay? Or you want to deal with a collector, okay? And the best way to deal with collectors is go on Klov, K-L-O-V.com. That's if you're in the U.S. In the U.K., they have RG, U.K. VAC or something. So go to KLOV.com, join the forum, look at the for sale threads, post a wanted to buy thread, deal with collectors there. The prices on KLOV.com tend to be reasonable and grounded in reality. Sometimes that's not the case, but for the most part, usually that is the case. But really, you're going to find the deals on Craigslist. That's where you're going to find them, and you need to search Craigslist every day, every hour, every minute. If you go to johnsarcade.com, go to the forum. I have my search list string. Again, I should do a video about this, but I basically have a Craigslist pop-up notifier in Chrome on my computer that keeps looking for my search string on Craigslist all over the East Coast. And when there's a match, it pops up and there it is. And usually I'm the first person to email people because of this little notifier thing. So again, you gotta keep looking, you gotta keep looking, you gotta keep looking. And people email me all the time and say, there's no good games in my area. I don't believe you at all. I just don't. I don't. You're not persistent enough. I'm telling you, you're not looking often enough. You need to widen your search too. Don't just search in your area. Be prepared to drive 100 miles. When I first got in this hobby, I said to myself, I have a 100 mile limit. That's how far I'm gonna go. And that's what I did. Now I'm a little pickier, but in the beginning, that's what I would do. So Ricky, again, good luck. And you know, eBay's okay, but really, the prices are way too high there. Next one is from Tony. You can get lucky on eBay. I bought my Mario Brothers on eBay for like $350, but that was a while ago. Hello, John. I'm a fan of your videos and think they are heavy with knowledge and experience. I'm an electrical engineer and am PC certified, and after watching your videos, have really thought about doing what you're doing, not only as a hobby, but also making a business out of restoring and selling classic arcade games to collectors such as yourself. I'm not sure if you have done any videos on the actual buying process. See, here it is again. But I was wondering if you consider or would be willing to do a video on the actual steps and way to search Craigslist.com or any other ways you come across these arcade cabinets. I've tried searching through Craigslist myself, but have not had much success. Would you please assist? Thanks kindly, Tony. So you can see I get a lot of these emails, and I do need to make this a real standalone video. But Tony, you know, I've tried giving you guys the information as much as I can. Again, go to John's Arcade Forum. I gave you my search string. I'm showing you exactly what I'm using to search on Craigslist. And you're gonna find stuff that you normally wouldn't. Like, if you just go type arcade, yeah, you're gonna find arcade games, but you're not gonna find every arcade game. I'm gonna give you a pro tip too. A really good search string is called takes quarters. just put in two words, takes, I'm giving you guys my secrets. Put in two words, takes quarters. Or type in quarter game. That's how you find the games that other people can't find. Okay, I'm giving away my secrets. If you type in quarter game, because a lot of time people will put up games on Craigslist that are arcade games, and they don't use arcade anywhere in the listing. They don't put the word arcade anywhere in the listing. It'll say video game takes quarters, Mortal Kombat takes quarters, Quantum quantum game takes quarters. No arcade. I have gotten games like that where the word arcade is not in the listing. And my search term that I give you guys has that in there, okay? So go to johnsarcade.com, go to the forum, go to the main video game thread. I think it's arcade game sub forum. And I have in there pinned, stickied, my search term. Use it, it works. And I spent a lot of time refining that. And I will do a standalone video, I just don't know when. I really need to, because again, I get tons and tons of emails of like this. All right, this is from Dean, okay? And Dean has an idea here. Hi, John. Just sending you an idea for the show. Since you have an audience that may or may not include CLOV, UK VAC, JAMA Plus, etc. members, I thought it may be cool if you could read out a couple of wanted posts for viewers who are in need of parts to complete their restores. I like this idea, okay? So Dean is looking for a Nintendo Space Firebird board set, okay? He says, selfishly, I'm in need of something myself. I'm in need of a working Nintendo Space Fireboard PCB to get my cocktail up and running, but I'll also consider Sega Gremlin and bootleg Space Fireboard boards, okay? I just want to get my game running, and I don't want to resort to MAME. Anyway, just an idea. Have fun. Hugs, Dean. Leslie 70 in the UK. All right, so Dean is looking for a Nintendo Space Firebird board set. Can you guys help him? Okay, if you can, I want you to email me at blkdog7@gmail.com. That's blkdog7@gmail.com. If you have a board for him, a PCB that you're willing to sell to him and ship to the UK, email me and I'll connect you guys together, okay? And you know what? I think this is a good idea. I don't know if I can do this every video, okay? But if you guys want to send me emails with your wanted to buy, like maybe rare stuff, okay? I will talk about it on the show. Do you hear that? I think that the clock on my Ghostbusters is off, because that's the Midnight Madness sound. Or does it just do that when it shows the Midnight Madness champion leaderboard? I don't know. But anyway, the point is, if you guys are looking for something that's rare or hard to find, send me an email. I will say it on the show here and try to connect you guys, okay? Maybe we'll make that part of viewer mail. Again, I don't know if I can do it every week, but just send it to me and then I'll try to read them on the show. And of course, my email is blkdog7@gmail.com, and you have to put viewer mail in the subject line. All right, guys, that's it for this video. I hope you enjoyed it. I'll see you guys very soon. Be sure to check out my podcast, Arcade Outsiders at arcadeoutsiders.com, Video Game Outsiders at videogameoutsiders.com, You Suck Show at YouSuckShow.com, my other YouTube channel, John Sucks at Video Games. Go on YouTube and search for John Sucks at Video Games. And then also go to ArcadeEvent.com, because Arcade Outsiders, my podcast, we're putting on an event, a tournament. This is our fourth annual tournament at Grinker's Grand Palace in Eagle, Idaho, which is an amazing arcade. Go to ArcadeEvent.com to register, which is free. The event is free. You even get a free t-shirt. Go to ArcadeEvent.com to register. The event is October 14th and 15th. Again, it's free to register. And then also on the site at arcadeevent.com, we have t-shirts for sale from BroFest and also the prototype tournament we did at CAX. Those shirts are 25 shipped, and those are we have a limited supply of sizes. So if you missed going to those events and wanted a shirt from BroFest and also CAX, go to arcadeevent.com and also, of course, go there to register. So that's it. We're done. Hope you guys enjoyed it. I'll see you very soon. Later, and bye.